we can't be an ostrich with our heads in the ground anymore. You know, there's just come a time where you got to stand up and you got to get your voice out there and speak up. Because if you don't, you will be walked all over. It's sad, but it's the truth. And that's how it works. If you don't say nothing and you don't fight for yourself, you will be stomped on. So I think the Hindus are all coming together now, because I feel for the first time in a long time that the Hindus are really uniting. And all this crazy stuff that the media says about Modi, and yet on the other side that India is a dangerous country, it's extremely dangerous for women. Like all this propaganda that you hear in the West that they're saying about India is so far from the truth. It just blows my mind. You know, you do hear about a lot of poverty and slums and all this other stuff, because that's only what the media puts out about India. And I still hear that today. People just look at India like that. But when I got there, it blew my mind. The hospitality of the people and just how they have the namaste and how they touch your feet. And how cow is holy. Like, you don't see this in other countries. The people are the nicest people in the world.
Welcome to the Indus Lens Show. Today we have a very special guest, Renee Lynn. She's an author, she is a social activist, and also founder of Voice for India. So Renee, welcome to Indus Lens Show.
Thank you. And thank you so much for having me. Thank you so much.
Renee, can you just tell us a little bit about Voice for India and how do you start it and what do you do?
Okay, so I started initially on a fan Facebook page, Voice for India, back in 2012, because my first trip to India was in 2009. Okay. And now I've been there 23 times. I just seen a lot of the discrimination, not just for the Hindus. There's a lot of fake propaganda and media being said about India that's not true. So it just aggravated me. I had to get the truth out about India, so and get my voice out there. Get my voice out there, because like it's Voice for India, but I'm also a voice for the Hindus, because there's a lot of discrimination against the Hindus in India. So that's what started this whole movement now, I guess, to say. It came really, really crazy and popular. I wasn't even expecting that to happen. So that's what happened with the Voice for India and my book that I released probably about a year and a half ago, India Stripped, about the mainstream international media and my personal experience. So that's what happened with Voice for India. And now it has really propelled by leaps and bounds. And I get so many messages and comments. Everybody wants to join in for the Voice for India project. So I love it, because I have so many emails, everybody saying that they're becoming more patriotic for their country. Motivate me, you inspire me. So that's great, because we want to inspire each other and motivate each other and become more patriotic. So that makes me feel good that the Voice for India project is really, you know, making people more patriotic and, you know, standing up for their rights in India. So that's what started the whole thing, was my love for India.
Okay. So before going to India in 2009, you said the first time, what was your perception about India as an average American? Because when we meet Americans over here, the image about India is very limited to Taj Mahal, chicken curry, naan,
yes,
and probably slums. So what was your image before going to India, and after you visited India, what was the transformation?
Yeah, so I guess like the average person, but maybe I wasn't so brainwashed, I guess, to say, like other Western people, because I do a lot of traveling. So I really didn't know what to expect when I arrived in India. I know that there's like over a billion people. And, you know, you do hear about a lot of poverties and slums and all this other stuff, because that's only what the media puts out about India. And I still hear that today. People just look at India like that. But when I got there, it blew my mind. The hospitality of the people and just how they have the namaste and how they touch your feet. And how cow is holy. Like, you don't see this in other countries. The people are the nicest people in the world. And just the small gestures that they have, you know, just namaste and touching your feet and the cow, it was so remarkable and like heart touching, because you don't see that in other countries. You don't, but India just blew my mind. And I just can't believe the hospitality of the people. It was just breathtaking. I just fell in love with India.
How do you got involved with Hindus, and you are being very pro-Hindu and being voicing the opinions of Hindu and talking about the discrimination against Hindus? So how do you get involved? What made you fall in love with India and Hindus at the same time?
Mm-hmm. Well, I was born a Christian, and now I've been a Hindu for a while now. Because it was the Hinduism was so practical and logical. And I just loved the Indian philosophy behind that. So, and I see the Hindus in India going there and being on social media, how they're always saying that they're discriminated against, how the temples in India, how they're controlled by the government. But the churches aren't, and the mosque aren't. And it's just like certain things like that happens to the Hindus, and they feel so discriminated against, and minorities always seem to have first preference. And India is 80% Hindu country. So for me, it was just mind-boggling. And they say that it's a secular country, but yet, It's really not a secular country, because the Hindus are always discriminated against. If something were to happen with a Hindu, media don't want to say anything. But if it's the other way around, then all hell breaks loose. It's like they always, I don't know how to say this, they're always trying to make Hindus look violent and intolerant. And the minority groups in there as peacefuls, but that's not the truth. But that's how the liberals in India and the media portray the Hindus as violent and intolerant, and Modi is fascist, and RSS is a terrorist organization. And I'm like, you gotta be kidding me. Like, this is so unfair. And they say it so, like, my heart just went out to the Hindus, I guess to say, because they are the nicest people in the world as a whole, and just their whole philosophy and things like that really just provoked me to be a voice for the Hindus too.
So when you say the people, they are talking about RSS and the media in India, but we also see the same stories, or matter of fact, even more dramatized stories, more bigger allegations in the Western media. Might it be the most popular print media or electronic media here in the United States? So their allegations are Hindus are fascists, they are killing Muslims or minority for that matter. And no one is safe over there. And there are Christian organizations who say the same thing over here. So how much of fact do you find in those allegations?
Oh, by the Western media over here?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my God. It's sickening. It really is sickening. A lot of them, like our governor here, Governor Murphy, you know, he had a lot to say about Modi is fascist, and he needs to ban stop this CAA, Citizenship Amendment Act, and all this crazy stuff that the media says about Modi, and yet on the other side that India is a dangerous country, it's extremely dangerous for women, like all this propaganda that you hear in the West that they're saying about India is so far from the truth. It just blows my mind. It just blows my mind. And I get annoyed because people believe it. They actually believe it. And just Friday, I went to a protest at Rutgers University in Brunswick, New Jersey. So we had posters, and the opposition party for CAA, who were against it, they were there too. So they're just shouting a lot of time, Azadi, Azadi, mm-hmm. you know. And then we went up to one of the professors there, and we said, can we talk to you? Because we wanted to share our facts. Because it seemed to us that they don't even know what CAA is. They were just there because the professor told them, but they don't even know what it was. So we just wanted, we had all the facts on their posters, and we just wanted to talk to them, to tell them how the minorities are disappearing in Pakistan, Afghanistan, and how they're being persecuted. And this is about human rights. But they didn't want to hear it. It's almost like, and this is so true, a lot of the liberals are just dumber than dumb. They don't even know what they're protesting against, because, you know, it might be mainstream in their group that they'll just go out and blindly follow people and believe them without doing research. Really? It was just.
So when you mentioned about going to the university campus and the students were brainwashed, and so these are very renowned universities and well-known universities. And as you know, a lot of Indian families, like rich Indian families mainly, would love to send their kids to U.S. Like universities for the
career. Yes.
So how do you think it is impacting those youth who are coming to U.S. for studies and they have been brainwashed, or do you think a bigger conspiracy behind it?
I'm sure there's some propaganda. I'm sure you heard of Audrey. Everybody heard of Audrey. I can't pronounce her last name. Chutsky, is it?
Chutsky. I don't know.
Yes, she was there, and she recognized me because she blocked me on Twitter because I confronted her, and because she was saying a bunch of stuff about Tariq Fatah.
Uh-huh.
So she blocked me after that. So I did a petition to Modi and the Indian government to ban her from coming to India because she hates Hindus and she hates India. So I got almost 14,000 signatures. Mm-hmm. And this is going back maybe November, December. And the reporter from Rutgers, Daily Targum, they reached out to me and I gave my statement against her. So when we went there on Friday, I seen her looking at me. So like, oh, she recognized me. So later, me and some other lady, they said, oh, let's go up to Audrey and confront her and just talk to her about facts. So we went there and the lady introduced herself and she just looked at me and she's like, Renee. So she recognized me from our little brawl we had on Twitter a couple months ago. And I'm like, yeah. So we said that, you know, we just want to give our points and facts about CAA. Mm-hmm. So then she says, oh, okay, later. And then we said, okay. So then later her and her students, they ran off. So we never had a chance to confront her. But we're saying she is brainwashed all them students because it seemed like they didn't even know why they were there. They didn't know anything except Azadi, Azadi. That's all they were really saying. And we wanted to share our facts to them. So she is brainwashing them for whatever propaganda she has because she hates Modi. She hates RSS. She hates India. She hates Hindus. That's why I want her banned from coming to India, because she's spreading lies and propaganda India, and she's spreading lies and propaganda here in the USA.
She has been feeding a lot fake things about India, fake things about, and she has a very big following from some other countries, which I don't want to mention. And obviously, we as the Indus Lens were blocked by her very long back when we brought up a couple things we know about her. So obviously, she doesn't like it. And that's good. I don't care about that part. And we are seeing this in a lot of other universities happening the same thing, you know, the brainwashing of Indian kids. So that is
and a lot of it is backed by Islamic organizations.
Yes.
Because when Governor, I did a speaking event at TV Asia on the day, the 30th anniversary of the Kashmiri Pundit. And I said, because Governor Phil Murphy of New Jersey, you know, he put out this statement that, you know, Modi's a fascist, this is discriminating. So of course I had to counteract, but that was funded by an Islamic organization.
Oh, yeah.
So
oh, yeah.
A lot of the propaganda is done from Islamic organizations that are feeding these people lies and all this other thing. Maybe they're getting paid. I have really no idea. Again, I never really investigated deep, but that sounds like an interesting topic. Maybe that'll be my next book, because that sounds interesting. But a lot of it is funded by Islam, and the same thing in India too, because she has all the Islamic organizations and left liberals backing Audrey in India. When she comes, she does speaking events and she sells her books in India, because when she goes there, they're paying her to do speeches. And she's making money from her books. So they're all supporting her. In the meantime, the sad thing is the youth in India are feeding into her lies.
Yeah,
that's what I don't like. She's brainwashing people.
Yeah, definitely. So when people like her, there are many of them we know on social media based in US. They had been talking and talking. Some happen to be exposed as missionaries. Some happen to be exposed as from the Islamic lobby. And so there are a lot of different pool of people who at the same time unitedly attacking Hindus in India, I guess. And based on that, they mainly has this has been got a boom all of a sudden after 2014, after Prime Minister Modi got elected and took the office. And since the propaganda has gone leaps and bounds, and it has been all over, more than ever, anti-Hindu propaganda has been done since 2014. So
yes.
how do you look at Prime Minister Modi or RSS? When you go to India, you had interacted with people from his party, or how do you look at that? Do they sound like anti-Muslim, or how do you look at the entire scenario, the propaganda that's been created against Prime Minister Modi?
Oh, I think it's disgraceful. I'm not sure if you know about it, but I just released a book on Narendra Modi. It's called Mission Impossible, the New 21st Century Iron Man. So that's in India and Amazon around the world. It made Amazon number one new release. And I just got great reviews. I researched that for 6 months, and I even learned a lot of stuff. And it's so, like, every time Modi does something great, like the Statue of Unity, here they come, they have to tear it down, and they have to say these horrible things about Modi. It's a waste of money. Modi does this great, and then they counteract him with something negative. It's like, no matter what the man does, right, they never have any great words to say about him. They always have to counteract with something negative. I mean, Modi has done such great work since he took office in 2014, cleaning up India, the toilets now, infrastructure, I mean, corruption. The man is awesome. He's doing such a great job. And for the first time in decades, he's standing up for Hindus, because they've always been discriminated against. And he knows that. So because he wants to help the Hindus also, you know, the left liberals have a problem with it, and they start all these riots like CAA and Article 370. So he also does work for Christians, Muslims. He does other minorities. He does. So he wants to look out for the Hindus too, because they've been neglected from other prime ministers, especially Nehru, who was so anti-Hindu. And it's just, you know, they always say that he's discriminating. No, he's not. And it's the same thing. And I wrote about this in my book. I wrote a lot about the same propaganda that's happening with Trump here. Since the day the man got elected back in 2016, that November, they've already had him impeached before he even started working in the office. Lies after lies after lies about Trump. And Trump is just like Modi, and I compare both of them in my book. Trump has done more in 3 years than any other president has done in decades. Obama was feeding the Middle East, Pakistan, billions of dollars, all the Middle East, just giving our money away. Trump stopped all that. He stopped feeding these terrorists. He's killing the terrorists. Who's the recent terrorist he killed? Soleimani? And then Baghdadi. So he's doing great. The economy is the best it's been in decades. Unemployment's the lowest it's been in 50 years. I mean, manufacturing's coming back. The stock market's booming. He's eradicating ISIS. This is wonderful things. But what does the radical left do? Oh my God, they're making lies after lies, and give the man a break. And it's the same thing with Modi, you know, because Trump is sticking up for the conservative Christian values. Modi is sticking up for the Hindu values, because both been neglected for decades from previous leaders. So, and both of them are very popular, but it's always the leftist liberal and their agenda. They, and if something's great and they know it, and they know it's great, either on Modi's end or Trump's end, they won't say it on the news media. All the news media, CNN, NDTV, they're all corrupt. They're all corrupt.
So another one issue that is always being exploited, I would say, the talks about Hindutva. When they talk about this word Hindutva, it has been demonized, and they try to equate it to neo-Nazis, and they try to equate it with white supremacists and stuff like that. And they say these people have been killing and lynching Muslims. From my perspective, because I had lived in India, I'm a Hindu, I know what Hindutva is to begin with. But second thing, I would like to ask you, as someone who is not from India but has often visited India so many times, what is your perspective about Hindutva? I'm pretty sure you might have came across with a lot of pro-Hindutva people in India. And what is your perspective about it?
Okay, for me, it's just like Hinduness. Basically, that's what the word means. It's like these people are just, you know, it's like, for me, I think it's interchangeable with Hinduism. But for some reason, people have this radical idea, like what you said, it means like Nazi and killing, but that's not it at all. Like it's like the same perspective that they have with RSS. They think that they're killers and they're mean, and they're not. Do you know how much work RSS has for India? All volunteer. They're out there when natural disaster happens. They go try to give voluntary water when certain issues are happening in India. They do so much great work, volunteer work. They're wonderful people. RSS is a wonderful organization. And here, the CIA had classified RSS and I can't remember the name of that other sister organization of RSS.
Vishwa Hindu.
Yeah, they organized them as terrorist organizations in the CIA World Factbook.
World Factbook, yes.
I was like, are you kidding me? You gotta be kidding me. These are two great organizations that do so much work.
Right.
It just blows my mind, the bad rap that Hindutav get, that RSS get. It's just really sad, and it upsets me because it is not the truth. It's not the truth. And a lot of people that get brainwashed easy are the youth.
Yes.
That they don't even want to take time to, like, research, you know, do facts. It's just like, okay, somebody said that. Okay, I believe it. Mm-hmm. It's just ridiculous.
Yeah. Yeah, for people who are listening and don't know exactly when Renee was talking about a lot of grassroots level works, these people go, they don't get paid, but they go deep into villages and towns where there are big disasters like earthquake and flood. They go and help people, rescue them, you know, provide food, you know, take care of the people, even when the government is not able to reach. I mean, since a couple of years, the government has got a lot better with that. Previously, I had seen when I used to live there, these people will reach where the government has not reached even after 3-4 days of the disaster. These people will go and help them out. So it's a very vast organization who does a lot of things. I mean, but... I'm not affiliated with RSS, but I had seen their work because as being a journalist, it's my first job to investigate when I hear something. So if I heard the allegations about RSS, I looked into it, and their headquarters is in Nagpur, Maharashtra. And they do some fantastic job, a humanitarian basis. And when they do the job, and the biggest misconception about it, RSS, it is a Hindu organization, which RSS concept is not at all Hindu. They are based on nationalist principles, as far as I had known about them. And RSS also have their Muslim wing that is called Muslim Rashtriya Manch. And there are a lot of, they have like 16, 17 different wings under them. And they do just a magnificent job. Only one complaint I have from RSS is they were not able to defend or counterattack the people who are attacking or maligning or denigrating them on the world level. I think that's one thing they should be working on. I mean, you might be doing a great job, but if you're not able to defend your image, then everything goes down the drain.
I know. It's just so sad. Like everything, they would label it as like radical Hinduism, right? And they make they're coining Hinduism as a violent, intolerant religion in India. How sad.
Yeah.
How sad. It's a beautiful ancient tradition. It's beautiful. And they're twisting it and they're perverting it into their propaganda agenda to make Hinduism and Hindus look so bad. And every organization that's like linked into Hinduism, why they're twisting it pervertedly like this and making it look like a terrorist organization. I just can't believe it. Just blows my mind, and they're getting away with it.
For people who might not know, that Hindus are matter of fact under attack from thousands of years till date. And the problem with which I personally believe, I know it's your interview, but I would like to your point of view when I make this statement rather than a question. I personally believe, like, recently, mainly after the social media getting so popular in India, the facts are coming out, our Hindus are getting more awakened, and that is the biggest problem of the other side of the people who are not used to seeing Hindus speaking up, who are not used to seeing Hindus talking about it. Do you feel the same way that I believe that's the cause these people are so mad or so frustrated with the current situation and all that you see? It's a pent-up anger that is coming out on the streets. Do you think my statement?
Oh, with the Hindus speaking up more?
Yes.
Yeah, no, I noticed that too. I think for a while, I think the Hindus were very docile and meek, and they really, because that's really a part of Hinduism. They're not like fighters, like, you know, like Islam fighting everybody. You know, that's just Hinduism. Like, everything's nonviolent, okay? They've always done protests like that. But now I think probably they just had enough of the invasions that's been going on for centuries. And I see that now. That's why I always get my voice out there and I tell them, look, we can't be an ostrich with our heads in the ground anymore. You know, there's just come a time where you got to stand up and you got to get your voice out there and speak up, because if you don't, you will be walked all over. It's sad, but it's the truth. And that's how it works. If you don't say nothing and you don't fight for yourself, you will be stomped on. So I think the Hindus are all coming together now, because I feel for the first time in a long time that the Hindus are really uniting lately. I really do. I think they're tired of the propaganda. They're tired of the lies. That's why I think it's so good for all of us to get out there on social media and, you know, encourage and motivate people, you know, stand up for yourself. So I do see that. And I think it's great, because we have to. Because how much longer, you know, because they're just going to do it again. And then Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, they're so biased. They're always locking, suspending accounts, like of a conservative Trump supporter, a Modi, a nationalist. We all get banned. But, you know, liberals, you know, they can say whatever they want and get away with murder. But we can't. So that's why it's so important to get our voices out. But also, it's sad that we have to say what we have to say on a different level, because if we get too strong and use certain words, then Twitter and Facebook and YouTube will ban us. So you have to, for people like us, you have to get your word out there, but be mindful of the words you choose. Because them social media sites that are run by the far left, you know, they're looking for us. They don't want our voices out there. Because I'm getting reports, you know, on Twitter of someone reported this, and you know, and there's a lot of times Twitter said we didn't find anything wrong with it. So I they tell me this person, you know, they don't tell you who the person is. They just tell you, you know, someone reported your account. So I know people are trying to, when you get your voice out there, the opposition tries to report you.
Right.
You know, so they can try to like have you banned off of Twitter.
Or an average American, as an American, what would you like to tell your fellow Americans regarding the issues we talked about, like Hindus or India, and whatever they hear by the Western media and the misconception of the propaganda rant? What would you like to say, anything, or make a statement to your fellow Americans if anyone is listening to this?
Yeah, that's why I wrote the book. It's actually India Stripped. Isn't just, it's for Indians in India. It's for NRIs. It's for Western people. Because in there, I talked about my own personal experience being in India so many times, the hospitality. I talked about the mainstream media, because what they're hearing is not true. Go for yourself. Read my book. Look, I've been there 23 times so far. It's a safe country. These surveys, all these reports that these journalists that they have on television reporting all this, it's not true. It's not true. India is safe. India is safe for women. It's all propaganda. Just go and see for yourself. I'm sure it'd be one of the most magical times of your life, just taking a trip to India, because the people are just so fascinating and so humble. And you just can't be blindsided and believe everything the media says, all these surveys. So, and it just aggravates me, because even like my family, right? The way they talk about India, they have this image that, you know, it's just slums and poverty and filth. And they don't know that the, you know, the cities are nice. You know, God, what are they thinking? You know, there's toilets out there, there's hotels. Like, they just don't get it. Like, they're so blinded. It just blows my mind. The beautiful countryside of India is magnificent. What a beautiful country. It's sad that they only have this one image of India. And you know, movies like Slumdog Millionaire don't make it any better for people when you have Slumdog Millionaire as a movie.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I have a couple of my American friends who went to India with me for the first time, and we went to Mumbai, and I just tell them, close your eyes, and we went to South Bombay, like South Mumbai.
Oh, okay.
And open your eyes, and I say, which country are you in? They say, I cannot believe it's India. I said, because you're blindfolded, that's why you cannot believe it, because Indian cities are as developed as some other major Western countries. I mean, so,
exactly.
Yeah, so
they don't think it's developed. I don't know what they don't even think it's developed. They think it's just like villages and slums, and it has no beautiful tourist location. Like, oh my God, it's just like it's appalling. Like, oh God, like you gotta be kidding me. So that's the media. That's the power of the media.
Okay. Before we end this, could you, what would be your message for the youth, whoever are in US or in India who are getting brainwashed, or Hindus as a society, and what you had seen has been going on, you had seen the investigated into media and seen India's past and present. So what would be your message to India and mainly to Hindu society?
Well, to the youth, you know, I just like to say, you know, don't follow this leader blindly, you know, investigate, do some reading, do some factuals, instead of just believing that, okay, this professor said this, I'll say it must be true, and then you're falling for lies. You know, go out there, examine, do some research, study, because a lot of this is propaganda, and, you know, people don't want to take the time to learn anymore, to investigate, to study. They just wanted like, okay, this person said this, so it must be the truth. This article said this, you know, go from all angles, all sources, you know, and then make a discovery for yourself. Because if I believed what the media said, what everybody said about India, I would have never stepped foot in India was true. And if it was true and I went there, and if it was so dangerous, I wouldn't have gone back 23 times.
Right.
So never listen to one person, one side. Do your own investigation. Hear everybody's story. If you're so misconstrued about anything and you really don't know the truth, then, you know, take it from all angles.
All right, Renee, thank you very much for your time. It was wonderful talking to you.
Thank you. It was nice talking to you. And thank you for having me on. I appreciate it.